I'm with Dr. Rajiv Kumar, Vice Chairman of Niti Aayog. He's no stranger to our viewers. Thank you for your time.
Hi, Rajiv. Good. Thank you for having me
again. We had a few discussions before, and it was a very big hit. A lot of people asked a lot of questions. They got to know you, got to know what you do. I think this is very good and very healthy because the worldwide audience gets more familiar with your thinking.
Good to know that. Good to know that some people watched it, and thanks for coming back. I mean, this is wonderful.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it last time.
Yes, and I wanted to start on the inner journey side because we talked a lot about the outside world.
Yes.
But towards the end, we touched upon the inner journey, and I think people are very interested in finding out your inner journey.
Yeah.
So what I wanted to discuss is whether you agree with this premise that a nation has to have a spiritual foundation at the individual level in order that this manifests externally in performance, in emotional ways, in stability and ethics and all of that.
Yeah. No, Rajiv, very much so. And but let me explain also how. I mean, it's not just an assertion or a rhetoric. And from my own discipline, you see, I mean, the definition of economics that we've learned from Lionel Robbins and others is that it's a science of unlimited wants and limited means, which is why it's called a decimal science. And so if you look at this definition of economics, clearly it's completely at odds with trying to achieve an ecological balance. You know, and it's, and as you can see more and more, that this is not going to work. Right, because if you are going to chase material wants endlessly, then the Western model, even in the Western model, which thinks about conquering nature and thinks about bending nature to the man's will and ego, you know, and in Marxist terms, you know, the last contradiction between man and nature, with all of that, you can't, now it's very clear that this planet will not survive if you had that sort of a thing. How do you change this? What is the way to change this? Is that in the Indian tradition, philosophical traditions, you've had this thing about Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, which says that man lives with nature. And when man lives with nature, it is necessary that man needs to have a degree of satisfaction. So you have to have what could be called rational wants and not unlimited wants. So how do you get to this thing about rational wants? But you see the logic that I'm trying to
build? Yes, 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 very clear.
Yeah?
Yes.
So, and rational wants or satisfaction can only come if you have an inner framework, if you have an inner sense of what is ethically, you know, important or what is ethically permissible in your, and you build that set of value and try to balance your needs, not just in material terms, but also in, you know, if you like, also in spiritual terms, also in, you know, in terms of ecology, balance, and social beings. So, you know, and giving you one or two examples. Chasing material means might well mean that you want to maximize material, objectives, that you don't look after your parents.
Right.
Okay? And because, you know, that's all right. I mean, my material benefits are met if I'm a nuclear family, so that's it. Now, that's a value which leads to a social breakdown.
Right.
Right? Material means might well mean that, look, I don't mind, I'll just go spoil the nature, I'll convert everything into, you know, urbanization and urban sprawl, and I don't know what happens to the nature, so that won't work either. Similarly, if we don't have an inner spiritual awakening,
right,
which says that every human being is as important or as good or as you, you know, the same as yourself,
right,
and carries the same, if you like, reflection of God Almighty within herself, then you don't respect the other.
Right.
And you therefore create a lot of dissonance and dissensions in the economy. And that then gets reflected in all that you do.
Yes.
So therefore, a nation which is based on some enlightened principles, which comes from every spiritual tradition.
Yes.
Forget the religions for a minute.
Right.
Every spiritual tradition emphasizes the same.
Right.
And if you do that, then you can achieve, if you like, much higher levels of happiness with much lower spoilage of nature and ecology.
So the ability to find Anand within.
Yes.
Because meditation leads to that state.
Yeah.
I don't need to consume in order to feel joy. I just have a ability to find it within.
Yes.
And there are established techniques to achieve that.
Yes.
So a community of meditators is happy without too much consumption.
Yes.
Now, doesn't the whole economic theory of consumerism go against this, in the sense that they're measuring success by how much more you're consuming?
Yep.
Now, it could be that some people who are consuming less are actually happier, but they'd be considered, you know, a failure. Like Gandhi would be considered, you know, he doesn't consume a whole lot, so he's a poor guy and he's backward. So is there an issue of the inner self, spiritual self, versus the whole model of economics, which is material based?
There clearly is a conflict here, and I would rather have what the Bhutanese call
an
index of happiness,
yes,
rather than an index of material consumption.
Right.
And GDP unfortunately measures only that.
Right.
So even as an economist, while being an economist, I'm acutely conscious that that evolved human beings should have a multi-variable objective function than a singular objective function, which is measured in just in terms of how much wealth you have in your bank or material assets. Because I think it's everybody will accept the fact that you will get that the quality of happiness, the quality of joy, the quality of satisfaction that you get from pursuing many different objectives in life is far better than having pursued only a single objective in life. And what you mentioned earlier, you see that it's an absolute fact, and I know this from my own practice of meditation for the last 30 odd years, is that if you get connected, and if you feel a sense of, the only word sounds very big, but pardon my saying it, but if you can get a taste of bliss while you are fully aware, then you very often you think of others as much, quite meaningless in life. And that gives you a great ability to do whatever you are doing, but in a manner that you are sort of, in some sense, distanced from it.
Yes.
So you get, very good word are two. One is that you become tatast, and you become a witness, so that you can do what you like, but recognizing that whatever you're doing is your duty, your dharma, but not necessarily for giving you the sort of, the experience of happiness or joy. Anand is the only word, actually.
Right.
That if you can get that anand, then the rest in some sense becomes, not materially relevant to you.
Right.
And yet you do it to the best of your ability.
And actually, studies show that performance goes up for athletes. Because they're not so stressed.
No, absolutely.
And they're not so invested in the selfish personal pursuit, and they're doing it spontaneously.
No, absolutely. And you see, and also, I think even Einstein and others said this, that some of the best thoughts, some of the path-breaking thoughts, do not come out of pursuing a linear objective.
Right.
They in some sense drop to you,
right,
while you're sitting there. And if you are, in meditation, and if you are connected, then you can think horizontally much more than what you can think if you're just sort of awake, rational and following a certain logic, etc. I suppose some of the best path-breaking thoughts in the world, in human history, have come from, meditation, contemplation, silence, then has come from being hyperactive, and probably have never come from people who are pursuing a material, goal, and exclusively that.
Now, if a nation pursues the happiness index idea of Bhutan, we live in a realistic world we have to look at, is a kind of a modern Kurukshetra with a lot of warring going on, a lot of competition for resources, a lot of border disputes, people after each other. Do you think such a nation becomes vulnerable because it is too good and therefore others are not? Now, if the whole world were Bhutan-like and spiritual, and if the whole world adopted Vasudeva Kutumbakam, then, we would be perfect. But if some people do, and others say, I'm hungry and I want to expand, and I'll take his territory and get his resources, which has been much of history, you know, then is a unilateral approach to total spirituality at the cost of the external, a kind of bringing our guard down and becoming vulnerable. And in that case, is it better to be sort of balanced and do both?
No, absolutely. Absolutely, because you must safeguard your own interest, if you like. I mean, because if you are developing a new paradigm of satisfaction or of enjoyment or happiness, or what, you know, then it is your bounden duty to make sure that external factors don't come and devastate it. I mean, don't come and sort of, you know, take you away.
Right.
So that I think, and we must learn from our own history, that we were perhaps somewhere there, you know, in our past, but succumbed to external pressures from people who didn't think, you know, on our ways. So I think it is, as we should say, that we want a, you know, you should be saksham along with being swasth and you know and spiritually, you know, awakened. And
yeah, I think we became too introverted at the cost of not being vigilant, perhaps.
Absolutely, and also we assumed quite wrongly, and I think maybe a little bit of our own, just this complacency that everybody else must necessarily think like us.
Yes.
And but you know, there is this balance, as you said, and in life everything has to be balanced. So you must not let your guard down. And yet, you must make sure that everybody knows that you are a country which has never invaded anybody else.
Yes.
Because you have been, in some sense, quite satisfied with what you have, because you have, one, you have enough, and two, you've had this whole philosophy of saying that, look, I don't need, not all of us need palaces to live in,
yes,
because we need, our happiness accrues from somewhere else.
We should optimize what we have.
We should optimize
for ourselves,
what we
rather
have,
than going out and grabbing.
But also guard it.
Yes.
In the sense that nobody should come and be able to, you know, take us away from that.
Yes.
And then, moreover, should never come a situation where we are told that because we think the way we do, that we are backward. And that marginal, and that utilitarian doctrine,
yes,
of John Stuart Mill is the superior one, and what you have done so far is, you know, only leading you into backwardness.
Sure.
I think that's just sheer nonsense.
Sure.
You know, so and we did give to the rest of the world a lot.
Because,
We still are.
Yeah.
You know, so but you're absolutely right that we need to make sure that we are strong, we are not vulnerable, and we have given enough signals to the rest of the world that we cannot be taken for granted, and I think that's the one to do. And you know, this strength, your inner strength, gives you this ability to be able to do this.
Thank you for watching. You can subscribe here and also hit the bell icon to make sure you get notified. To donate, please click this button.